thank you very much on behalf of not only myself, but the New York Film Academy for coming to spend some of your time with us.
Sure.
I'm going to open with a couple of questions, and then I'll open up to the students here at the New York Film Academy. My first question, I think, would probably be the obvious, would be, coming from a director of photography background, how does a director of photography who's directing a project hire a different director of photography?
Actually, it's really easy.
Okay.
So people always ask me the question because they think, oh my God, he's going to be so critical. And in reality, because you have such a clear vision of what you like, what you want to see, you can be extremely precise in telling to the DP what you're looking for. And most directors have no idea what they want, so they're kind of very vague and they hope that you give the right answer. But I was very precise in what I was looking for, and then and of course you look for people that you know a little bit, that you work, you know, like in this case Jack Green, and he's a great guy, I love him. And therefore it was like relatively easy. So this is what I'd like to see, and now and you think you know you could do that? Are you interested in it most of all? Because it's a very physical movie, as you can see. There's a lot of that were real effects and not just only visual effects. And he loved it, and he got along extremely well. And you know what is one other thing that's really so important with as a DP director is that, you know, they always ask me, you know, when I was shooting movies like On Diet, whatever, Lethal Weapon, any of those movies, or Hunt for Red October, it's like, how much longer? It's okay, 10 minutes. And of course, it's always 20. and or sometimes longer because the sets are sometimes so big and doesn't work out, whatever reason. In this case, when a DP tells me I need 10 minutes or 15 minutes, I can see he needs at least 15 minutes or 20. So I must be able to defend him against the producer, say, no, he really needs 20 minutes. It's okay. It's fine. So they like, most DPs really, that the ones I've worked with, really, I mean, they love it because they find somebody who defends them, you know, so it's good.
And my second question would be, here at the New York Film Academy, we teach the acting students filmmaking and the filmmaking students acting. In your opinion, is that an important attribute for any student?
Let me tell you a little bit about, when I went to film school in Holland Film Academy, they did exactly the same thing. So, you had to learn to be an actor, a cameraman, a editor, and record sound, those four things. And so I was completely not interested in acting, of course, but I had to. And that's probably one of the best things that happened to me because standing in front of a camera is so difficult, and you're so dependent of what the person, the director, tells you, and you need so much information. So if you understand that, then later as a director, you kind of feel the need, what the actor has to go through, all the problems you go through. I think it's extremely important. And I recently saw some of the little movies we did in Holland in the late 60s, a long time ago. And I remember seeing myself, there was in the film museum, and there was a movie in which I had to be a model for underwear. And I didn't even remember that. And certainly it wasn't a big screen. It was full. That was a little embarrassing, I have to say. But I did learn so much of that. And I think it's like, you know, it is try to stand in front of a camera, try to say some lines, try to just walk in a room and walk out in a natural way. It's very hard, very, very hard. So you really have to understand what acting is all about. And of course, apart from the storyline and the character, et cetera, it is really important that you deal with actors. And you can only do that if you kind of forced to do it a little bit. I mean, stand in front of a camera, it's really important. Even you make your own little movie and try to portray something, you find out how difficult it is.
I'll leave this basically third question, and then I'll open it up to the audience. We had Andy Garcia that was here.
There we go.
Andy Garcia was here to talk a little bit about his work as not only an actor, but also a director as well. Mm-hmm. We screened his film Lost City. Now, this is a film that he had been an actor in. He was the director of.
Yeah, yeah.
He was the executive producer of. Yeah. And this was his passion and his love.
Uh-huh.
Is there a film that you have done in the past or that you're thinking of in the future where your love will be specifically that, or maybe even something that you're currently working on?
Actually, there's a couple of movies that I've done over during my lifetime, and it's like one of them is Turkey's Delight. It's a movie that I always be very close. It's a Dutch movie. I think it was nominated for Best Foreign Film Academy, And it is because it was like the a movie that we, the whole crew basically, it's based on a book from a Dutch writer. And we, I never realized how much I enjoyed filmmaking as on that movie. I mean, we had a film crew, there was maybe a total of 12 people, 13 max. And we became like a unit that worked together day and night, including the actors. We were always together for, I think, 7 weeks. And that kind of created such an incredible, you know, we all were on the same line. We all knew exactly what the stakes were. We all knew exactly what to do and what the story was. And everybody could talk to everybody. So it wasn't like the director has the only say, the final word. No, anybody had an idea, he could, you know, he could say it. And if it was any good, we would do it now. And that was such an amazing thing. And that is those things that I learned in Holland, I never was able to achieve completely here, because everything is very separated here. Like, you have so many professions, and you know, if you go from a crew from 12 to a crew of 200, that's a big difference. And here become, it's director is more of a manager, of a managerial position, in which you have to know everything about everybody and everything about all the technical parts of filmmaking. You know, not only the directing part, but you have to know about sound, you have to know about costume, you have to know about cleaning, how long it takes to clean somebody's costume. It's ordinary, simple things, set design, lights, and it's an endless list, visual effects, special effects, what time of gasoline to use for bombs, what kind of, you know, it is the amazing things, what kind of cars have to have to get at a certain speed or through a corner. It is kind of amazing, the things you would never, ever thought about having to learn about movie making. But as a director, you have to. I mean, at least for the type of movies I have been involved in. But coming back to that, is there a movie? I mean, there's a couple ones that I really like. I like Black Rain is one of my favorite movies. I still like very much. I do like Speed still, because it was like also, that was the closest to whatever I had done in Holland. A small, relatively small crew. Everybody worked for very little money. And they only did it once. And that was what I told them, that after this, next movie, everybody's going to get paid their real fee. And that was so great, because everybody had also this feeling like, you know, this is one group of people making one movie together. It wasn't like one person at the top and then, you know, and yes, and everybody just has to work their asses off. It was really a pretty great experience. But there's still some other projects that I am working right now on a project called, one is Black Tulip. You probably know that story. It's about in the 18th century, there was this, one of the first bubbles in history. I mean, this was a bubble about tulips. Everybody was investing like crazy in tulips, and it became so expensive that a black bulb for one tulip was valued at $100,000 at the time. And everybody was speculating like crazy. Of course, when people started to realize that after, you know, a whole country was totally energized by this bulb trade, that they were only dealing with flowers, and that basically a flower grows and it dies, you have nothing left. And then that bubble came up and also fell down really quickly, and the economy of Holland at the same time collapsed pretty much. And it's so funny, because like we are living in a time where there are so many bubbles, and it's funny that Holland was one of the first countries where one of those happened. And that's one of the movie projects I'm working on right now, which I really like.
Fantastic. So if you guys have questions, feel free to go ahead and stand up. Just come straight around here over to the microphone. And while we're waiting for some of the kids to stand up.
Sure.
You've worked on a tremendous amount of action pictures. Mm-hmm. Do you feel that's your genre? Do you feel you have a genre?
The thing is, like, you know, in Europe, you're never forced to get into a genre. And once I started working here, and people liked certain things, they force you. And I, you know, you try very hard. I mean, everybody tries very hard not to being pushed into this show, because it's a little dangerous. Because if action is all you do, I mean, in my case, you know, I was lucky, because it was the I think, the best time of action movies in the 70s and I was in the 70s and early 80s, and that was lucky. But normally it's not a good thing to be forced into one area, because you want to spread, you want to do different things, and everybody should make an effort to try to diversify a little bit and not just focus on one particular type of movie, not just action or thriller or comedy. It's much better for yourself personally as to just try different genres.
Right. Hi.
Hey.
How you doing, sir?
Hello.
Perfect. Good movie. Very entertaining. What would you say would be the most? What was the most difficult thing about making Twister, if you could recall?
Well, the most difficult thing was, and I don't know if you noticed or not, but we were filming during the season where most tornadoes do happen, and of course. The year we were filming it in was a year that was an incredible soft summer, and no tornadoes were visible in hundreds of miles. And not only that, the skies were always totally blue. And so I had to, oh my God, how can I possibly make a movie where the skies were always sunny, but there's no wind? And so we basically had to come up while shooting, how are we going to solve this problem? And we designed a system with sky replacement that had to be affordable, because we didn't have any more money, because everybody thought the skies would always be dark in Oklahoma, which they aren't. And so we found a system with ILM that we could relatively easy, meaning it would take us several days for every shot to replace it. We had a second unit team filming skies in all the states around it where the weather wasn't so good, like Nebraska, and try to replace the sky, use that sky, and put it in all the images we did in Oklahoma.
Oh, perfect. Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
My name's Adriai Hudson, and I'm a filmmaking student. So Chris explained to you that we also take acting classes, but one of the other classes that we do are cinematography.
Mm-hmm.
And so granted, I've only been here for 2 weeks, and I've done 2 one-minute films, but I was wondering if you had any advice on how to capture the image that you have in your mind and make it... to present that exact same image that you have in your mind to the audience, or to make it even better than what you have in your mind?
It's a difficult question, because it's different. It will be different for everybody now. I mean, like, what I feel and think is not necessarily what you might think would be the best solution for that particular shot. But what is very important to me is that you, there's intention in the picture, in the image. If there's no tension in the picture, then to me, I'd do something wrong, because I feel if there's no tension, there's nobody would be very interested in looking at it. And I always try to manipulate to a degree the image or the image quality to make people look at the screen. And when I started making my first movie, which was in the 60s, I started doing handheld almost exclusively, and I thought at least it felt like it was a little bit like a documentary feel to it, but it felt like audiences were looking, they were like a little bit more participating in the movie. It was somebody's point of view. It wasn't just a nondescript point of view by static camera, and where the audience is kind of just has to figure out what is interesting. You kind of are forced to really focus on what I wanted you to see. So that's really I think a really important thing you can learn, actually. It's like, what is important in, if you see an actor, do you put an actor in the middle of the frame? Do you see him on the left or right? Do you see him from behind? Is his face lit up? Is he in the dark? I mean, there's a million different ways you can make it interesting. Are you moving away to the actor or toward him? Or it is kind of exciting to really, find the right solution for every particular scene. But there is, the one mistake a lot of cinemas is to make it just all similar. I think I hate it when movies have and when it's too beautiful. I don't like when things are too beautiful, because then I feel like I'm distracted from the image. I lose a little bit the intention, but I cannot look at the actors anymore. Because if there's beautiful skies and beautiful this and long lens shots, that to me is like completely distracting. I'd much rather have the camera right in a person's face. I mean, and I loved, as a cameraman, I remember, I loved to talk to the actors nonstop. I whispered, left to the right. And they could see me, and they did. And that was, and the director never saw that because the director's behind me. And that was great. They loved it because quite often they don't know what to do, and especially in action scene, how many times can you say, reaction to a big action, but how do you react to that? No, I mean, it's like everybody can always get, watch out! And then, of course, that's like, if everybody would say that, it would be pretty boring, no? And it's never written in any screenplay how actors have to react to this big event. So I was trying to guide them and I sometimes push them away with a camera so that they have to move, so that there's a connection between the actor and the screen.
Thank you.
Come.
I was wondering, how did you go about attacking the film? Did you have experts?
Sorry, can you repeat that? Because it was too much noise.
How did you go about attacking the film? Did you have experts in the field? How much pre-production did you?
On Twister, you mean?
Yeah, Twister.
First of all, I did go on a couple of those storm chase runs. Have you ever done that? It's fantastic. It's really, really cool. It's like, there's nothing more scary and exciting than chasing a tornado in a car, especially the car. If the car is a little slow, because then you have to really find ways out of it. But I got so excited by that, because it's like the force of nature is so amazing. And I said, that's what I really wanted to get on the screen. It's like there's nothing that we can do that's even close to what nature can do. So so I knew that we had to have a lot of, you know, I went to meet with so many of the storm chaser guys, saw all the footage, and hired quite a few of those people, because I thought, you know, they know where we have to go, number one. Of course, and we didn't know that it was going to be like a sunny shoot, but they were guiding us, in, at least also in what the people would do in the cars. All the equipment was right, and we had actually real Dopplers with us, and that would work, but there was nothing to see because there was no tornado in the neighborhood. But anything that those actors do is relevant to what a real storm chaser would do. So that took a long time to get the cars right, because it's like we needed like five sets of cars, basically, of each car, because they always had to move left and right. Many cars got damaged and had to be patched up, repainted. So the pre-production was extremely long, but most importantly, the visual effects in this movie, this was a very beginning of visual effects a little bit, and a lot of them had never been done before. So the studio did not let us make the movie until we could prove that actually we could create a tornado on visual effects. And so we had to develop, I mean, I was involved in the developing of the particle system that didn't exist. So another thing that a director sometimes has to do, but that was a kind of exciting, because, you know, it's the particle system, and we figured out had to have at least 12 million particles for it to work. And that means we need extremely powerful computers to deal with all that information at a time. So ILM and all the supervisors, they had to rent supercomputers to really to be able to store it all and to put it together. I mean, the rendering of some of that shot in the film at the end, that the big tornado at the very end, that took 2 days to render, just one shot. So, I mean, in these days it all goes a little faster, I have to say. But the whole post production took very long time, because it's like, you know, they told us we cannot move the camera ever. You know, because otherwise ILM could not match it. And then when the first day I was shooting, I told the guy, no, we cannot do it. It has to be handheld. It has to be, I have to feel this rough quality to it. And they freaked out completely, because they had never, the tracking of shots in those days was extremely difficult, very time consuming. And so they were forced to design a system that's a little easier. It still was very slow, but at least twice as fast as it. So the whole post-production was like probably twice as long as they had imagined it to be. But it's the software design was actually kind of exciting to me. And also the visual effects, special effects on camera, which was really fun. I mean, like blowing real ice cubes into actors' faces and real straw and hay and debris. We had this you know, like the sequence on the road when it starts hailing. Now, we had two gigantic 40-foot trucks. We had one camera truck in the middle, like six cameras, and then two big trucks with huge ice makers spitting out this ice and aiming it right over the top. It would fall on the actors. I mean, that was actually more fun than anything else. Because
for you.
Was, I mean, Bill Paxton got one. I mean, we tried to make him as small as possible, but there was one big clunker in there that hit Bill Paxton in his head, I remember. And he was, and you can see it actually in the movie, he was bleeding like crazy, but he really, he said, stop, no, keep going. And he loved it because it was really cool. It was like a really fantastic thing for him, an experience who nobody experienced, like in the back of a pickup truck standing in the hill. It's pretty cool. So there's a lot of things we had to practice and endlessly rehearse, and sometimes it works and sometimes it don't, and you have to find other solutions. No?
Cool, thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
So I noticed in the film, earlier when I looked it up, and also just as the credits were rolling by, just what an incredible cast you had. I'd forgotten everything from Helen Hunt down to Alexa Vega, who played her when she was a little kid.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, what are some of the specifics of how you got those characters into those really intense scenes where, like, the two main characters are confessing their love for each other, or when they're chasing the tornadoes?
Mm-hmm. Well, the casting for this movie was really difficult because it was going to be an expensive movie. The studio, of course, wanted big stars, and I didn't want big stars. I wanted actors that you could believe could actually play the part. You would live that. I didn't want to be like actors looking at stars the whole time. So I wanted actors that looked natural, that could act naturally, and I always had Helen Hunt in mind for the part, and the studio refused to let me do it. And they came up with all other actors nonstop, till a week before shooting, when there was absolutely no chance left, no choice left for the studio, and we still had no other actor. We had all the rest of the cast, but not the Helen Hunt. And they finally were forced to say hello. And then Steven said, "Okay, let's try it." But it took a long time to convince them. And I got some really good actors in the group itself, you know, like Alan Ruck, for instance. Like a lot of actors that I saw, and that I saw was fantastic and really to work with. But the parts that we had was all small, relatively small, and but they were so excited. I was able to get a lot of young actors that had, you know, a lot of them that they became actually very well known and very successful.
Philip Seymour Hoffman.
He came in the read. He was one of the last persons we hired. It was like, we had to leave for Oklahoma, and I said, no, I need this one guy. And he came in the last. He was sweating like a pig. He was like really looked like he just woke up or so, and he had no idea what he was there for. And so I had him, and I said, oh wow, that looks perfect, you know. So I said, no, this is the right guy. And Risa Brehme Garcia, who was our casting director, and she said, oh, he's fantastic. You'll love him. He was great in Stacey. And then I did a test with him real quick, because so in case I had to show to the studio. But I loved him. I tried to create more scenes for him, but there's only so much I could add for him. But it's like, I loved when he's singing, when he's sitting in a bus, drinking his little thing. And it's pretty cool. I love. He's a really fantastic. But he was nervous like hell. Let me tell you that. His first movie. Did I answer all your questions?
I was just wondering, sort of, what you would do with the actors to get them into the more intense.
Oh yeah,
film.
Yeah. I think it's not different as many. You rehearse a lot, and you can only rehearse to a certain degree, because you cannot rehearse like running in the field with debris being thrown at you. But what the more intimate scenes, you have to rehearse, and because that had to be the same kind of feeling and tension than the rest of the sequences. So I wanted to make sure that it had this kind of a relatively intense, a ruggedness to it, but at the same time there was emotion to it. And with Helen it was relatively easy, but a lot of the actors was a little harder because they like to do physical things, and you know, like it was a little difficult for me sometimes to get them to do the quiet sequences, because they said, I should have run it. No, you're not going to run. You just sit there for it. But it's not much different than any other movie. It's just rehearsing, talk about it, listen what they have to say, very important, and really let them play it and let them, especially let them do it one time the way they like to do it and see if there's anything that you like from it and then try to use it, because it's really important that you listen to them and that they, that you really hear what they have to say, because ultimately they have to play it, no? I mean, you cannot just, they cannot become just like robots and just running from left to right. This really was so important to me that they really understood what it all meant, you know? Like, I really wanted them to drive the cars. I didn't want to have, like, normally in Hollywood movies, you have a big tow car and the actors sit in the car behind it, and they all fake drive. Here, the actors, they had to drive. And that's much more, I mean, it makes it much more real, no? It's like, it's a little bit tricky sometimes. Like the helicopter shot when, very early on in the movie, when it's a big wide shot, what I remember, the camera sets really high up, and then we see the red truck, and then the camera comes closer, 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 till close up in the car. And that was dangerous, because these were the actors driving. And the helicopter was at one point like 20 feet away from the car. And he was one of the best pilots in the business, and I knew he could do it, and he totally guaranteed that it would be safe. But for the actors, they were, no matter how I explained it to them, how close it would be, they were scared shitless, because if you see a helicopter the distance of half this room, it's pretty close, especially with the wind blowing. And, but it's but they liked it. They were really troopers, and I think the after a couple of weeks of shooting, everybody was so into the whole feeling of chasing and roughness. It was just pretty. They kind of, some of them went sometimes chasing in a weekend in the state next door, which we totally told them not to do because we were afraid they would never come back. But but at the same time, they got this feeling what it really meant to chase a tornado, because it's really, I couldn't recommend it. It's really cool.
Thank you.
Okay, I have a serious question and a more fun question. I'm originally from Oklahoma, so I get this, you know,
yeah,
and the fear and everything. But what drew you to this theme? And then the more fun question, while you were filming in Oklahoma, how did your diet change?
Oh, that was pretty awful. Sorry. But that changed massive. I actually always wanted to make a movie about forces of nature. And I wanted to do one time make a movie about a storm. You know, like in film history, there's a lot of movies made about big storms, hurricanes, and I was always looking for a project like that. And having seen tornadoes, you know, relatively close by, I said, this is like, you know, this has never been seen yet. And it's like, it's the excitement is so amazing, because you cannot. It's a little bit of an addiction now, because if you see it, it's very hard to actually steer away and go the other direction, but which you have to do. But it's because you're kind of drawn toward it, and that I have to say I was drawn toward it as well. I mean, and maybe I like danger a little bit, but it's something that to me is like anything. You know, when you've seen storms in Antarctica and they're so amazing, so powerful. I love watching that, and I love to see actors in those type of environments. I love to see a story being told in something that's not like a, you know, like a love scene in the living room or in a bedroom. I just wanted to get a little bit outside. And if the food, I mean, that was like, by the way, it was a major difference. I mean, I had never had really fried food like that in my life. It's like, and it was every day, morning, lunch and breakfast. It was every, I mean, like, there was like, we one time had like a truck come in from a bigger town to really bring us some, you know, different type of food for a change. But it was like, I mean, I have to say, the crew in generally gained about 10 pounds. Yeah. So if that answers your question.
Thank you. Hi. So you talked about Holland and America and the difference in filming. And I think you made a really good transformation to American movies. And coming from Holland, I was wondering, what is the biggest change or the biggest obstacle when you went over to American movies?
there's a, there's actually several issues. Technical, first a technical issue, meaning, like, you know, to work on a studio movie, you had to be a union member, and to be a union member, you have to work on a union movie. So it's kind of a catch-22 situation. And a lot of people have, were dealing with that. You know, like when you come from a lot of DPs, a lot of art directors. So what they did is like you try to do make a very low-budget movie, and then you ask the producer if he's willing to unionize after the shoot, meaning he doesn't have to pay the union fees and dues during the shooting, but he will give you the rights to unionize after that. He has to pay some fees, I mean, but it's still a lot cheaper than paying for a whole union crew. So if you do that, then you can, those shooting days will then be, you can use those as saying, I worked on a union movie. So you needed, I think, at the time, 100 days or so. So, and that seems like a lot to me, but because the movies in Holland are like, you know, 5 weeks, you know, like nothing, you know, it's like, and so, but ultimately I was lucky enough to, because I was lucky enough to always find work here, that I really very quickly got my 100 days. And that is the number one thing that you have to, I mean, I don't know how exactly, if it's still the same, I think it's still pretty difficult, but there's a lot more independent movies than there was at that time, you know, right now, more independent movies than studio movies. Another thing is that I was used to operate the camera. And as a DP, that's a very European thing. And to me, it's extremely important because I cannot possibly imagine if a photographer asks somebody else, okay, you make the picture, I just tell you how to do it. So I feel like you have to connect with the actor. And I always, you know, like I said earlier, I always talk to the actors while filming it, or I move, and so I get to know. I get to know a little bit how they are, what they're thinking of, what they like to do, and trying to kind of indirectly a little co-direct a movie to some degree, and that was like impossible. So I remember that on, I think it was on maybe Hunt for Red October, that, you know, I did it already before, but then that was such a big movie, the unions start suing me for this, that I could not do it anymore. I needed to hire operators, et cetera. And that movie, because I don't know if you've seen it, but it has a lot of very small sets and on moving platforms. There was just no space for an operator because it was just too small. So I did everything handheld. And so I could basically help to the director himself to find ways to visualize it. And so the studios, really, they were really behind me. They were saying, "Listen, they totally got it that I had to do it," and they basically helped pay for my lawyers at the time to and we won the lawsuit. I mean, but what happened? The result was that basically, as long as I hired operators, multiple operators. I mean, and if they would be there and they would be doing other stuff, it would be okay. I mean, so even if there only would be one camera and I would only operate that one camera, then there still had to be another person there. If he sat on the chair all day long, that was fine too, as long as he got paid.
Nice job.
And then, of course, the crews, like the biggest difference is the two more things, the size of the crews. In Holland and Europe, you have very small crews, no? I mean, and suddenly here you have a crew of, before you know, there's 90 people, and in a bigger movie, it's very quickly, you know, like 150 or more. And that was like a big difference for me because I had to really learn how to deal with so many people. You know, it's like you, and that means like you have to do a lot of homework, and meaning like you have to, you have to know what the next day, what the schedule is, what has to be done. Prepping is incredibly important for at the time. And like, for instance, like the scenes in Die Hard where the big building, the helicopters fly around that building. We only had one night to film that sequence in. And I think I used 28 cameras or so because there were scenes on the ground, in the streets, on the rooftop. It had to be lit completely. There were 4 city blocks that had to be lit. And in Century City, and they only give us one permit to fly over at once. So that had to be extremely well prepared so that you're not over, you know, I had, there's tons of lighting, but they were all kind of hidden. So that's number one, where, how to light a set, how many generators. I think there was like 14 generators all hidden behind buildings, and the sets inside the building had to be lit, and on the rooftop, there was a big scene on the rooftop, all at the same time. So you have to find ways, and that's a lot of prepping. It's like, how do you light a scene like that where you don't want to see the movie lights, and they use a lot of fluorescence, and you get a lot of you know, on top of that, one more thing. So I needed also a film helicopter to film the other two helicopters. So how can you keep everything out of frame? How can you not see the film camera, the film helicopter, for all the other cameras on the ground? Mm. So that is a massive, massive preparation. And that's something that, first of all, you don't do that very often in Europe. And it is something that you really have to learn. And because the whole crew depends on you, on the DP mostly. They're not so much on the director, because they quite often, they sit in a trailer because it's too complex for them, because it's really, it's too many cameras, too many things. They tend to, and again, it's like, you know, like if you have, you have to work with so many people, and they and you have, like at one point there was four sets of walkie-talkies talking to the, on top of the building, around the building, behind two blocks back, and they all had to run at this at certain times at different speeds. And so it was like probably the most complex thing I've ever done, but it was kind of fun to do it as well, I have to say. And then one last thing is a little bit, it's like, you know, like the last thing with adaptation from Europe to United States is that in Europe the movies are 4 or 5 weeks, and the very first movie I did in LA, it was a movie called Roar. It was like 20 lions and tigers and elephants, God knows how many animals. It was with Tippi Hedren and Melanie Griffiths, and they said it will take about 5 months. Except 5 months, I had 5 weeks. I expected it to be, and of course that was like a movie that you know, that became like the disaster movie of all times. Meaning that after 8 months, the set burned down, and animals escaped, so a lot of them escaped, so they had to be, you know, the whole crew was helping to catch all the lions and tigers, which was not fun, let me tell you that. It's really scary, especially with tigers. If you see the eyes light up a little bit, you have to get out of there as soon as you can. And so that took a long time to rebuild the set. Then there was, we started filming again, then there was a massive flood, and one of those bad rainy winters in LA, and a dam broke in the canyon above, and the whole set got flooded out. So rebuild number two, and again, some of the lead animals died in that, some of the lead lions, and so that was another awful thing. And then the last thing happened to me in the same movie, and that was my welcome to Los Angeles, is that we did a scene, there's a big lake in the set, Tippi Hedren and Melanie Griffiths were on a boat, they were chased by the lions and tigers on the shore, and I was filming several cameras again, of course. I had a scene, dug a hole in the ground, and the lions would be coming over the camera, and then I would pan to the actors on the boat, right next door, under the rowboat. Of course, everything went well. I mean, to a degree it went well. The lions did run over the camera, and the actors were screaming and yelling, panic. And of course, one of the lions came back and walked back towards the hole in which I was hiding and bit me in my head. And I thought, this is the end of my life, you know, because I knew it was really dangerous, because I couldn't see anything anymore, because my skin was totally, I was scalped basically. It was hanging in front of my face, and I knew it was very soft and bloody. My assistant completely fainted right away, and everybody else was listening to Melanie and Tippi screaming on the side of the on the boat, because there was a scene, there was the air. So, and then I started to scream, but nobody paid any attention to me for at least a minute. And I knew, I learned one thing is that when you ever work with lions and tigers, make yourself as big as possible. Get up, put your hands up in the air as high as you can, and make as much sound as you can. But I think it's because I couldn't see anything. I just hoped that I didn't go towards the other lions. And finally, one of the trainers saw what, you know, they were all watching. It was their fault that they were not watching me. And then they come with a fire extinguisher and got the animals away. But I was in the hospital for a really long time. I had 236 stitches in my hand.
Wow.
So that was my welcome to LA. So it's not that easy.
And you're still here. Wow. So. Okay, thank you for answering.
Thank you.
Well, in terms of pre-production, how long did it took you to prepare Twister and to shoot this incredible film?
I think the pre-production was about 5 months. And some of it was in LA casting, and then a lot of it was on the set. And then a lot of, it's three sections. It's a special effects preparation and testing. That's a big stage because there were so many really special effects, because it's not all visual effects in a movie. Anything that blows up and cars twisting is all real. So that had to be tested out, you know, and we had to build a tanker, very lightweight material, so we actually could blow it up and things like that. The plane, you know, we had to take everything out, and these are all real planes. In those days, you still did that, and now you wouldn't do that anymore. And then the shooting was about 17 weeks, I think, 17, 18 weeks. And that sounds like a lot. And it is a lot, but it is like when you have a group of people. We had like 40 tractor trailers in the crew and in the technical crew. I mean, like 10 of them were special effects, and tons of them were for costumes. Tons of them were for just debris, just strong debris in front. We had two jet engines on special tractor trailers to create wind, real jet engine. Then we had like 10 gigantic propellers, the big ones, and it's only, and you, they all have a very relatively short range of impact. So the jet engines you only use if you need it, if it has to reach the back end of the wall, for instance, no? But it's like for actors, very unpleasant, because the fumes of a jet engine are, you know, you don't want to stand, but there was, in those days, that's all we could do, no? And I remember that Helen was always complaining crazy about the smell of it, which she was right. I mean, it's like, it's unpleasant. But so there was so much equipment. And then we had to, most importantly, we had like six or eight tractors to always pull the trucks out of the mud, because they always got stuck in the mud, because they always had to park them in the field. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you know, who would ever think that you need eight tractors whose only job it is to pull big tractor trailers out of the mud. But so that was like and then post-production at least 6 months, maybe, I think, might be a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Well, that was mostly the visual effects, no, because that was just nothing. But there was still like a developing world, very much so. And there was a lot of, you know, testing and trying, and didn't work, you have to do it again. And so all in all, it was way over a year, yeah. Mm-hmm. Year and 3-4 months, maybe.
Thank you.
Hello, sir. As a director, what were some of your greatest challenges when working with actors to communicate your vision to them, and how did you overcome those challenges?
I think, you know, because I worked with so many other directors as a DP, and I worked, you know, in many different types of movies, thank God. And so I've been aware of what is kind of needed for actors, you know, how, and I always found the most difficult part is that actors are always the most insecure when it's a big scene, it's a big action scene, because they feel not familiar with it, they don't know what to do, they don't know how to run and not trip, they don't know like what to say, because there's never written dialogue for them, and that is so difficult, and they always think everything is dangerous. I mean, and that is, of course, the most important part of a director is to make them feel safe. And again, it's like it has not little to do with acting, but it has to do with, like, if you don't feel safe, they cannot act. So quite often I try to do the stunt for them. I'm relatively clumsy. I'm not really good in jumping. But if I felt if I can do it, they could do it too. they should be able to do it. So there was many ways, like for instance on speed, like when Keanu jumps from the Jaguar to the bus, that looks like a difficult stunt, no? And we absolutely did not want to do it. He said, no, I'm not going to do it. It's too dangerous. And I said, okay, I'll do it for you. And I had no idea what it was in for either. But in reality, actually, you know, it's more like a fear within your heart. Is that it's because you see that the road passing by very fast, and you both go at least 50, 60 miles, depending, you know, like what the scene was. And so in reality, the best thing is not to think about it and just step to the bus. You know? When I did it the first time, I did step in, but forgot to hold on, you know. So thank God he wasn't watching. So, but because he just looked away, and I was so happy he didn't see that, because he would have almost fallen out of the bus. And so I had to do it again, and this time I did it right. And then, of course, he said, okay, well, if you really want it, I'll do it, but I really don't want to, but I'll do it. And then he finally did it. And it looks good. So it's basically, it's like you have to convince him it's safe, because you don't want to use stunt people. I can't stand the use of stunt doubles. I mean, because I want to really see the actors, you know, doing that to me. If I cannot see an actor's face in a stunt, is the whole stunt is meaningless, because then anybody can do that, and it's like it becomes so prefab, and it becomes like there's no emotion. But the moment you see an actor's face in a scene like that, and you know, when Sandra drives the bus, he actually drives the bus. And once he hits some other cars, she actually hits another car. And you cannot act that, you know. It's really hard to really put it in your mind, oh, I'm going to do this, I'm going to react. It's impossible. But the reactors, and if they are at ease, and if they feel really great, and they feel safe, most importantly, then you get incredible reactions, you know.
Did she jump the bus, too?
No, unfortunately. Well, fortunately for her, she didn't,
I should say.
Because we had, there was actually a funny story. So the studio didn't want us to film that, and I said, oh, we have to, otherwise we have no scene. So let's do it in a weekend, or let's not just tell the studio. And basically, which we didn't. So we built a ramp, and we had this car, the big truck, I mean, totally empty, all the chairs out. And so we tried to figure out, the special effects people, how far it would jump, no? This, I mean, if you drive 56 miles an hour and you go this far, this, it probably will land somewhere there. So we can put the cameras then another 10, 15 feet further away. That should be totally safe. So the first time I was ready, cameras rolling, and of course that bus took off at the highest speed and landed on top of all cameras. Boom. Everything wiped out. And which was, of course, you know, I had to talk to Panavision. They said, no, we have to keep this secret. We cannot let them find out. Because we have to do it again, number two. And I need some new cameras. Can you get me some really old cameras? It doesn't really matter what it is. I mean, as long as you have an anamorphic lens, and I promise I will put the cameras much further back next time. So again, the studio never saw the dailies, of course. And then we did it again the next weekend, like at the end of the day. So we had this guy, the driver, a real stunt driver. He was sitting in a seat like this. When you're in a bus, you don't want to be sitting to something that's attached to the bus when you crash land, because you break your back. So he was hanging in a harness, like on rubber. So you kind of float a little bit, but it makes it very hard to steer if you ever want to try it. So the driver, the stunt was so excited. It's like, this time it's going to be really great. And he was sitting. He did a jump, and he was so, yeah! And he stuck his tongue out. And then when he landed, he bit the tip of his tongue out, because he was, I mean, he shouldn't have to stick his tongue out, of course, but he was so excited that it worked, that we had to bring him to the hospital. I think they put it back on, and he's okay now. but this time the stunt worked, and we had no broken cameras, and no, so, but, And when the studio saw it, they said, oh my God, it's fantastic. Now, then they loved it, of course.
Right.
We would have never gotten it if we would have told them how we would do it.
Right, right.
And what happened, really. So.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Hi, my name is Felipe. I'm an acting student. My question has to do with the fact that you're from Holland and what the process, what made you want to come to the United States and the process of getting into the business here, and what advice you would have from people that are not from the States that want to get into the business here?
I started making movies when I was 14 years old. I made a little wedding film for friends and family. I had a small 8mm camera. And from there I went up and I went to high school and I started a film club in high school only because they would give me a 16mm camera. But there was only, I had only two members, a teacher and another student. So that was the whole film club. But what I really, you know, wanted after, you know, working in Holland for a long time, I worked, like, did a lot of movies in Europe and Germany, is I wanted to go to Hollywood. I really felt like I could have kept working in Holland for a long time in Germany and Belgium and England, but I would never gotten to those movies, the bigger movies that I really wanted to do. You know, one of my favorite movies was Bridge on the River Kwai. I want to do one time a movie like that, something like really with spectacular events in it. And so I knew I had to do it one time. It's just like, the hardest part is when do you make the decision in your life? It's like, you know, and because it's when you move from Europe, wherever you come from, it doesn't really matter. You basically have to start all over again. You might as well forget that you've done all those movies, because people forget very quickly here. So they know you, they've seen maybe some of your movies for a couple of months, and then they're waiting for what you're going to do here. So it's very important that you make the choice. Whatever you do first in the United States, make a right choice. Don't fall into a trap of doing something that is a bad movie or is really nobody's going to see, because you get very quickly into the wrong, it's a wrong entrance into this movie business. Try to find something that has a little bit more, you know, value, more class, a little, even if it's, but don't be afraid to take a small job. It doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be a big job right away. But really, do not make a wrong choice, because it's like I've seen many other people come from Europe. They always ask advice, and they always want to go right into the big movies. Well, that's not going to happen. You know, that just it's rarely happens. So they really want you to prove that you, first of all, want to be here, number one, and secondly, that you really have talent. So what does help is when you make your own little movies. I would recommend to anybody, and make your own little movies and make showcases for yourself. And really, it's so important, because that they trust. They trust that much more than the stuff you did in any other country. So that's one of the most important lessons I can give you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Hi. I've read on a website that the Yippee-ki-yay line in Die Hard was improvised by Bruce Willis. And I just wanted to know about how much freedom you like to give an actor when they're working on their character, be it in lines or in characterization work.
You mean Yippee-ki-yay motherfucker, no?
That one.
Yeah, no, that was him. That was definitely him. Because he kept saying that on and off throughout the movie, so he found at one point the right spot for it. So, no, I think you have to listen to actors. As I said earlier, it's like actors do have good ideas, you know, and don't be afraid of them. It is like what I, you know, when I met movies, I've worked on movies that were written and directed by the same person. The directors always had lots of trouble when actors changed the lines. They like, because that was the perfect line, no? And I think it's really important to have the actor or actress make that line her own or his own. And you really have to listen to it. So you have to give him some freedom. Of course, there's a story to tell. They cannot change the story. But there's many ways to tell that same story. And I really think it's extremely important to listen to them and to get a trust. Because if you do that, you're going to get a lot more out of the actor. I mean, it's quite amazing. It's like, get them on your side as soon as you can. And of, I mean, I'm not saying that they should rewrite the whole screenplay, but if they have ideas that are really that relate to that character, that really make that character more real, absolutely listen to it. And don't be afraid of it at all. It's good.
Thanks.
Okay.
I'm really wondering about how did you approach big studios which were involved in your projects? And the second question is, I saw that you were working with Steven Spielberg. I'm interested about your relationship with him and about your, how did you start to work with him and what was the whole process?
Okay. With studios, it's just a matter of like, I already knew the studios now because I worked on a lot of bigger movies. It just was the transition from DP to directing was a little hard, but they knew that I did. For instance, I always did all the second unit. Now, when there was big action scenes, the directors let me do it because it was much easier for them, and so the studios knew I did that. So they knew I could handle those big scenes. So basically, I found this script speed that was at Paramount and. They hated the script because who in the hell ever wants to see a movie about a bus and it only goes 50 miles an hour? How boring! And so they didn't. They wanted to get rid of it. And the script was was much different then. I have to say than it is now, of course. But I really could see the potential in that. And I went to it with that same script to Fox and to Peter Chernin, who was at that time president. And I told him my ideas, and it took 45 minutes to convince him. And that's pure luck. I mean, it doesn't take a lot longer, a month and years sometimes. But that was my first experience, and it was like, and of course they were, you know, the result was extremely, you know, good for them because they made a fortune out of that movie. With Spielberg, he saw Speed, and he came to me and said, oh, we have this project and about a Twister. And so we got to know each other. I went, and he lives relatively close by. So I went to his house and he showed stuff about it. And he asked me what I could do to make that a more exciting move, because the script wasn't really there at all. And we had, like, it was based on a big screenplay by, what's the writer's name again? Michael Crichton and his
Michael
wife.
Crichton, right.
Yeah, and but it wasn't. And if you read the original script, and if you look at, I mean, you've seen the movie now, it's basically the same story as My Girl Friday. It really is. If you really almost scene by scene, and I didn't know that. I mean, I love My Girl Friday. It's a great movie, but it needed a lot of work to make it a lot more of a little bit more intense and exciting, adventurous, and then they asked me to hire some other writer, and Jeff Nathanson, which is a young writer at the time, he had never, you know, he did two TV series, but I really loved his attitude, loved the way what he thought about the whole tornado world, and he was with me on the set all the time. That to me is like the way I so much prefer to work, if the writer is with you all the time. Most writers don't want to do that, by the way. They get very bored after a week on the set and they want to leave. But he was the one, because it was his first movie, he stayed on the set the whole time. And we could rewrite the screenplay, we could really give the characters a lot more to do and give them a lot more character than I was ever able to do, which was fantastic. And Steven liked that so much that working with him, then he started hiring this guy, and he did a lot of movies with Steven after that. But we became friends, and I had a movie at a time that I was developing for myself, my Minority Report, and I really liked it a lot. And he had a movie called The Haunting that he was going to direct, and Tom Cruise wanted to be in Minority Report, but he wanted to do it with Steven, and I wanted to do The Haunting because I like working with the team that they had assembled there. So we kind of switched a little bit. So he got my movie and I got his.
Wow.
And it worked out for both of us. It doesn't happen very often, I have to say. I mean, I was really lucky. And you know, the film business is like you know people, but you don't see them all the time because everybody's always working. They're gone, so it's all the first relationships are always the most important because that's what people remember. So whoever you deal with on your first project, you know, it's going to be an important relationship because they will remember you more. Even if you don't work with them for 10, 20 years, they will remember you, and they know exactly. And also, they are the ones who will tell other people what they think of you. And that's a little bit how this business works a little bit. They always call other people. What do you think about him? What do you think? Is he okay? Is he slow? Is he fast? Is he able to work with the studio? Because studios, I talked to Chris before a little bit about, it's like, every director wants to make his own movie and wants to have total control. In Hollywood, you don't have total control. You have no control. In some way, you have all the control in the world, but only if you know that the final result has to be a movie that works. And you're absolutely out of your mind if you don't listen to other people who have some creative input that is actually effective, that would make it a better movie. So you have to be very open to other people. I mean, unfortunately, I think the last decade or so, the studios have a little bit too much input. They really are starting to direct out of the office a little bit, and they are giving you, they see the dailies, it's not good, do it again. And that is not good. I mean, it's okay if they give advice and say, no, but they cannot direct a movie from a stage. And that's a little bit a problem at the moment, I feel, with movie making, is that there's too much similarity, because it's like, it's office filmmaking, I'll call it a little bit. And they kind of, especially with younger directors, they take over control very quickly, and they take it away from you. And in post-production, when the editing is, and you think you made your movie, then they take over and they start re-editing your movie. And it happens so many times. And that's what you have to be. So it's much easier, the reason I say all this, it's much easier to cooperate with them a little bit and pretend at least that you're agreeing with them, or you will try to do what they suggest. That's much better than to just fight them. You cannot fight them. It doesn't really work.
Thank you.
We have time for one more question.
Hi. I just wanted to ask about the film Basic Instinct and what it was like working with Paul Verhoeven, and also where some of the inspiration came for the cinematography, which was amazing.
Thank you. I worked with Paul many times. We went to the same film school and Film Academy, and I did his first movie. So I did maybe six or seven of his movies. We started, so we had an amazing, good relationship. And then he's the kind of guy who says if he trusts you, you can do anything you want to do. Basically, for him, it's not important. He's not one of those guys who directed something, it has to be exactly like that. And he listened to you, and he knows it's what he's going to get. It's good. And for that movie, I really had to come up with an idea, a little bit like that. That ultimately all comes down to several scenes in the police office where she gets interviewed. And fortunately, the production designer had made all those big rooms for all those interrogations. He said, no. Ceiling has to come down. So you should almost be able to touch the ceiling. I want there no space to be beside from her. She has to be the center of that whole, that sequence. And so we was able to change the whole set to really basically develop a style of photography. So, which is kind of different. Normally that doesn't happen very often, but because we have such a good relationship, he totally trusted me. When I told him, you have to do it, we have to bring it, he said, okay, let's do it. But a lot of those inspiration comes from Hitchcock movies, no? I mean, like, as you can see, I mean, there's a lot of similar locations even, on the West Coast, south of San Francisco. So there's a lot of, obviously, I'm a big, I love his movies, and there's some of them were absolutely brilliant, and you can watch them over and over again. And I think this movie has, a visual style that is partially modern and partly is it, from the 50s, 60s, mm-hmm. early 50s, I would say more. And it was just right, it's just like, it's, I don't know how you get to do these ideas. It's like you read the script, the film has to come together in your mind first. I mean, when I start doing a movie, you have to see the movie in your head before you start doing it. You cannot, figure out, oh, we'll do this, and then figure out how. It doesn't work. You have to see the whole movie in your head before. And if once you have that, then the rest is relatively easy. But that's definitely Hitchcockian, that's for sure.
Thank you.
Well, on behalf of the New York Film Academy, we would definitely like to thank you for coming here. And I usually end these interviews with a little bit of a story about Kevin Spacey. Kevin Spacey actually came to visit the students as well and spoke a lot about his mentor, which was Jack Lemmon at the time. And long before Kevin Spacey was the actor that he was, Jack Lemmon was actually one of his instructors. And Jack had told him, "You definitely have it." He said, "And when you become successful, I want you to do me a favor. Once you make it to the top and you ride that elevator to the top, spend the rest of your time sending that elevator down for the next generation."
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I agree with that.
For sending that generation back down.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And good luck with your future. I hope you all will be good filmmakers.